Jewish Education and Media is pleased to present L'Chaim, a program that highlights the people, issues, and events of importance to the Jewish community. Now here is your host, Rabbi Mark Golub.
I'm Mark Golub, and it goes without saying that a major issue in the Jewish world today is the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. Is there any way to find a peaceful resolution to this conflict which enables the people of Israel to live in security and calm without having to worry about the safety of their children or grandchildren and anyone they love? Without having to worry about suicide attackers and knifings and shootings and rockets? Is there any way to work out a relationship with the Palestinian people which will dramatically change the status quo in which the Palestinian in Israel and on the West Bank and Gaza and in Lebanon and in Syria will no longer spend so much of their resources and energy on destroying the Jewish state? For many years, the majority of Jews worldwide, beginning with Israelis, have believed a solution is possible. It's gone under the rubric of the two-state solution, in which Israel would facilitate the creation of a new Palestinian state on much of the disputed territories known as the West Bank, and that the Palestinian state would coexist with the state of Israel, would cooperate with the state of Israel, would even build an economic region in the Middle East that might rival the European Union, the Asian market, even that of the United States. But this idealistic vision seems to more and more be a difficult reality to implement. And there is now in the Jewish world, certainly among a growing majority in the state of Israel, and within the American Jewish community, an increasing understanding that the real human tragedy of the Israeli-Palestinian conflict is that there is no Palestinian leadership prepared to share the land with the Jews of Israel and to live in peace with the state of Israel. There is simply no one in the Palestinian leadership today representing a legitimate peace movement among the Palestinian people. Well, for some insight on what all this means, I'm so pleased to be joined by an Israeli who must live with and write about this explosive quagmire on a daily basis. Ben-Dror Yemini, one of Israel's leading journalists, who is currently senior journalist for the Hebrew daily newspaper Yediot Ahranot. Ben-Dror has also worked for the paper's competitor, Ma'ariv, and he's the author of a fascinating overview of the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, soon to be translated into English by Nebraska University Press. It's entitled The Industry of Lies: Myths and Facts Regarding the Middle East Conflict. And Ben-Dror Yemini writes exclusively and extensively on matters dealing with the way the radical left has joined with radical Islam in efforts to incite anti-Israel actions. And he's written many pieces refuting anti-Israel claims. Ben-Dror, it is such an honor and pleasure to have you sitting with me. Thank you so very much for joining us.
Thank you for hosting me.
You know, before we began, you mentioned to me that you were recently on the Columbia University campus.
Yeah.
And you spoke at their law school.
Yeah.
And you made an interesting distinction to me. I wanted to wait till we were on camera for you to discuss. You drew a distinction between a bias. Many peoples have biases. They are biased. You drew a distinction between a bias and an outright lie.
Yeah.
And it comes back to, again, the title of your own book.
The Industry of Lies.
The Industry of Lies, yes. Yeah. I want you to talk for a moment about what you mean and why it's important for us to understand the difference between bias and lie.
Yeah. When you are biased, you don't have to lie. I mean, you emphasize, for example, the sins that Israel is committing, and you say it again and again, disproportionately, in many ways. You are biased. I mean, you don't like Israel, and you emphasize. But lies, it's something else. You are telling about things that never happened. When yesterday in Columbia University, in the law school of Columbia University, I opened my lecture with some examples from Columbia University professors. For example, Joseph Massad, who wrote that in Tel Aviv, you don't have Muslims. It's the only Western city in the West with no Muslim and or Arab inhabitants.
He wrote this?
What do you mean? Of course he wrote it. Just one example. I mean, whoever...
That's a lie.
I mean, I live in Tel Aviv. Of course it's a lie. It's a blatant lie. What do you mean? And he wrote in the very same article about a speech that the Prime Minister of Israel, Benjamin Netanyahu, gave in the UN General Assembly. And he said, according to Professor Massad, that Netanyahu called to expel the 1.6 million Arab citizens of Israel. It never happened. The only one sentence that Netanyahu said about the Israeli Arabs was that Israel will always do everything to keep the rights as full citizens of Israel. Just the opposite. Just the opposite. It's not bias. It's not bias. I mean, I don't like biased professors. I don't like. But it is not bias. It's blatant lies. Yes. And it's not the only.
You know, in some way, everyone is biased. The only question is how severe is the bias and how much does it get in the way of their seeing the truth.
Yeah.
You're talking about a much more serious problem.
Completely.
By the way, did you give any other examples to your Columbia audience?
Oh, yeah. Some other professors just as well.
Give me one more.
For another professor, that Hamid Dabashi, I think, that from its inception, the State of Israel wanted only to murder and to maim Palestinians. What? I mean, and then we get to numbers and proportions. So, I mean, sometimes we don't really know how to distinguish between bias and lies. For example, when Professor John Mearsheimer, one of the authors of the book against AIPAC, when he is claiming again and again that the Nakba, the Palestinian catastrophe in 48, is one of the worst crimes in modern history. Then you ask yourself, according to what? According to what? To how many people were killed? To how many people were forced out? According to what? What is your, how do you rank? And once I asked him, and of course he didn't answer me, I can give so many examples. The president of MESA, Middle East Studies Association, a very important academic organization here in the United States. They teach about the Middle East. And Professor Juan Cole, the president, and he wrote an article claiming that what happened in Gaza is the worst crime in colonialism after what happened in the Belgian Congo. In Belgian Congo, by the way, 10 million people were killed. And altogether, under colonialism, it's 50 million people that were killed. How could he put what happened in Gaza as the worst crime?
Okay.
After? I mean, and there are so many examples of how they manipulate, exaggerate, and lie.
Okay, I think you're saying something very important, but I want to push you just a little bit. I find somebody saying, you know, there are no Muslims living in Tel Aviv. That's a lie.
Yeah.
When one says an event is the worst event, that's not a lie. That is their bias. And it's a distinction that you try to make. And I'm suggesting that when you use the word lie, it has to be factually clear.
Yeah, I'll tell you why it's
so
a lie.
So even the Netanyahu line, I think, tends to be a lie.
Yeah.
But I don't. I think when somebody says, oh, this is the worst thing that happened since the World War II, and the worst thing that happened is Hiroshima, worst thing that happened since the Belgian... I may disagree, but I don't think they're lying.
You know what? You know what? I don't mind. We can call... the only one thing that I can do in my very limited power as a researcher is to present the facts. For example, if you are speaking about colonialism and what happened besides the story of the massacre, the genocide in Congo, is just to give the numbers. And I guess the numbers speak for themselves. Mm-hmm. I mean, if 50 million were killed, and in every, I mean, let's take Algeria, the war for independence. Something like between 500,000 and 1 million were killed during the war. I mean, in Gaza we are speaking of, I mean, it's part of colonialism, needless to say. But in Gaza, we are speaking, according to whoever it will be, about 2100.
Correct.
Now, can you compare it? Can you say that it's worse? So what is it, a bias or a lie? I don't know. Let's leave it in a question mark.
You say it very well. You know, the subtitle of your book, The Industry of Lies, is Myths and Facts Regarding the Middle East Conflict.
Yeah.
What do you feel is maybe one or two of the most serious misunderstandings because of the myths that surround this conflict that people have in general, or American Jews have as you come here and you talk to them? What do you find that really both surprises you and troubles you?
Yeah, okay. I'll give you two.
Please.
One a historical example, and one from the nowadays example, which is connected to what Sander said. The historical example is the biggest crime of Zionism, the Nakba. And they repeatedly say that it's really a crime against humanity, what Zionism did.
Who do you hear say that?
Ah, so many.
Almost, here in America, too?
Yeah, of course, of course. It's not only John Mearsheimer. It's almost every second professor that dealing with the Middle East conflict is saying that Israel committed
okay.
a crime.
So in the halls of academia here in America, the Nakba is a big deal.
It's a big deal, but the second one is the altogether human rights story, human rights...
abuses by Israel against Palestinians.
Now, let me tell you something. Well, let's speak first about the historical story, Nakba. Did it happen? Yes, it happened. 700,000 Arabs, they were not even called Palestinians in that time. They became refugees. Some of them, during the war, were forced out. We have to admit it. I don't say that it never happened. But we have to make, in order to understand that it's a manipulation. It's not a lie because it happened. And we have to distinguish between lies and manipulations. It happened, but we have to zoom out. And when we zoom out, what we find is that actually it happened in every conflict in the first half of the previous century.
There was nothing new here.
It's not tragically, but it's nothing new. It's not only that there was nothing new, it was the norm.
The norm.
It was recommended upon by leaders like Winston Churchill, like Harry Truman, by philosophers. It was initiated by someone like Fridtjof Nansen, who received even the Nobel Prize for Peace, for initiating and conducting population exchange between Greek and Turkey, for example. The highest international court of that time recommended upon to carry out population exchange. But when people don't know it, they think, and when the Nakba is singled out, And when you have every week two conferences about the crimes that Israel committed, people think that it was the only event of transferring people out. Now, actually, it happened in every conflict. Actually, there were more Jews that were forced out from Arab countries. The Jewish Nakba, nobody's speaking about. So the outcome is a huge manipulation. But that's what young students hear. I'll give you an example. I gave a lecture in Northeastern University for young students, fresh students. And then the professor that I spoke about just came to class, and he told them, look, Israel committed the crime. And the student, he was equipped with information. He raised his hand, and he said, but dear professor, you know, it happened in Europe, Ukraine, Poland, ethnic Germans, Hungary, Sudetenland, and so on. Then he told him, we are speaking now about the Israeli-Arab conflict. If you want to say something about Europe, go to a history lesson about Europe and say it. Then he again raised his hand. Dear professor, we are speaking about the Israeli-Arab conflict. Yes, we are speaking about Israel. But more Jews were forced out from Arab countries because of the same conflict. You know what? In that very moment, I won. I won because knowledge is power. Mm-hmm. Knowledge is power. The whole anti-Israeli campaign, BDS, and not only BDS, is based on ignorance. Ignorance is power for them. And when people are ignorant, they can be manipulated. When they know, they cannot be manipulated. So the only one thing that I want them is to know the facts. It doesn't mean that Israel is perfect. It doesn't mean that Israel does not have any misdeeds. Yes, we have. And we criticize ourselves, we in the Israeli media. And I'm proud. Many times, you know, I'm presented with articles from Israel. And look what the Israeli journalist or academic wrote against Israel. Now, my answer is always, you know what? I'm proud. Because what you just raised now, it's the best proof that Israel is a democracy, a robust democracy. Mm-hmm. We have everything. We have academics. We have journalists. They can write whatever they want. We criticize our government because Israel is a democracy, because we enjoy the freedom of speech. So we don't need manipulations. We have a democracy. Everything can be argued against the government. I'm proud about it.
Everybody says knowledge is power, and it is. Ignorance can also be power if it's used by those who want to destroy. Anybody who really understands Israel, Ben-Dror, must feel it is a magnificent social experiment which happens to be conducted today by the Jewish people.
I must tell you something, I mean, just following what you said, from a very personal point of view, about my family. I'm allowed, yes?
By the way, it's not you're allowed. I was going to say to you, who the heck are you? I want to know how you become you. All I know is you're a Sabra, born in 1954.
Yeah.
That means, by the way, you're roughly 13 years old when the Six-Day War occurs.
Yeah.
And then I said, so how do you become one of Israel's leading journalists who really brings a perspective we don't get to hear? Tell me your story.
Oh, my story is that I was kicked out of high school. And yes, and I sold...
How did that happen?
You know, my high school was just
where
next...
Where was this?
Just in Tel Aviv, just next to the district court of Tel Aviv. And I liked to go to listen to trials. I was interested. By the way, I became a lawyer because in my profession, I'm a lawyer. So that's what I did. I went, and then I went to the sea because, I mean, it's a wonderful beach that we have in Tel Aviv. So I was kicked out, and I went...
How old were you?
Roughly. I was 15.
Okay.
15, 16. When
and
I
they
was
kicked you out of school.
Yeah, and I didn't make any high school eventually. And then I went to the army. And
at 18?
Yeah, at 18. And my mother became sick, very sick.
I'm sorry.
And I knew that she wants me to be something. So immediately, I mean, in 1 year, I finished all my exams in order to be accepted to university, which I did. And then I went to study.
Where?
And unfortunately, my mother passed away, but she knew that I'm
you were on the right track.
Yeah, yeah.
Exactly. Where did you study? Which university?
I studied in Tel Aviv University.
Is that where you got a law degree?
And I went to the IDC, which is the Interdisciplinary
yes.
Center.
Great
and
school.
In both of them, I studied yes. Humanities, law, and eventually I became, for a short time, an official. I was the assistant of the absorption minister, but it was for a short time. But what I liked to do, and I was a lawyer, of course, for some years, but what I did all the time is writing. I mean, it's my love. I mean, I like to do it. And I did it, and for many years I was, I have to emphasize it, it's because it is important. I was a peace activist. Before the Oslo Agreement, I went to meet Yasser Arafat in Tunisia.
What was that like?
Well, it was nice. It was in the middle of the night. I mean, we were cold. And we met there. We became friends with two guys that became famous later on, Jibril Rajoub and Omar Barghouti. And they became close friends, mainly Barghouti became a very close friend of mine.
Really?
Completely.
Was Arafat charming?
Completely, yes, he was charming.
Could you understand why he could have such an impact in the Palestinian world?
Yeah, it was not the only one meeting that we had. He's a charmer, he's smiling, he's touching. Yeah, it was quite an experience.
So at the moment in this story,
yeah.
You're a peace activist
yeah.
who's meeting with Arafat
yeah.
and some other top Palestinians,
yeah.
leadership, and you're liking them.
Of course I do. What do you mean? Of course, I want to make peace. I'm striving for peace. I'm a peace activist, and I write articles in that time, even when I'm loyal. I write articles for Yediot, and then Mariv, and then again Yediot. And a big supporter of peace, a big supporter of the Oslo Accords, preaching for peace and participate a lot of meetings with Palestinians. But I do remember two events that made me worried. It's not only two, but two examples.
That shook you.
Yeah. Immediately after the 1 year after the Oslo Accords were signed, Arafat gave a speech in Johannesburg when he said, "I don't mean peace. I don't mean peace."
Is this Hurabiya?
1994. It was in Johannesburg. It's called
in a mosque.
No, in university. No, it was in university, a meeting with Muslim students. And it was quite amazing because I do remember myself writing an article, a kind of open letter to Yasser Arafat, telling him, "I'm looking for peace. We are looking for peace. Most Israelis are looking for peace. And what you're saying is not peace. It's manipulation."
Do you remember what he said?
No, I was misunderstood. I mean, you know, when you are challenged as a human being, with something that is contradicting your beliefs. Most of us live in denial. I did not want to live in denial. But I gave excuses, like, for example, well, after so many years of conflict, that's the way he speaks to his people. It happened again in Stockholm 2 years later, 96, when he repeated the same kind of idea. "I don't really mean peace. I mean to bring Israel down." And I was... I had some, you know, red lights. But I think the turning point was not the turning point in my views. I do want peace.
Of course.
I'm looking for leaders. But I think when he, Yasser Arafat, rejected the Clinton parameters.
At Camp David.
after Camp David, because Camp David failed, and then the two leaders, Ehud Barak and Yasser Arafat, told Bill Clinton, who was really familiar with the details, you know what? Put your own initiative on the table, which he did after some months, at the end of 2000. Now, the point is that Israel accepted. I mean, it was not easy. Don't misunderstand me. It was not easy. And Arafat came to Washington in order to deliver his response. And he met some Arab ambassadors. And there was a turning point. Why there was a turning point? Because for the first time, the Arab states accepted the idea of two states for two peoples. Not two states. There is a huge difference between two states and two states for two peoples. And the meeting was headed by Ben-Dror Ben Sultan, who was called the prince, the Saudi Arabia ambassador to the United States. At the end of the meeting, he told him, go and say yes. We had enough. But if you say no, it's not going to be a tragedy. It's going to be a crime. A minute after, Arafat went to the White House and committed both a tragedy and a crime because he said no. So it was quite disappointing. It was quite disappointing. And then some other things happened in 2001. For example,
the Durban Conference. Yes.
The Durban Conference was a festival of hatred against Israel, against the very existence of Israel.
And at the time it happens, are you surprised? Because you still are idealistic.
Yeah.
You've worked so hard for reconciliation between Israeli and Palestinian. Two-state solution was the mechanism. The larger ideal was there will be a reconciliation between these two peoples. We will live together in peace. And that was the ideal, and you were an idealist. And then Durban comes, and you feel what?
Something is going wrong. I ask my friends from the NGOs, peace activists. I mean, we are striving for peace, not for the destruction of Israel. We are peace activists. And I have to admit that I did not receive good answers. Something happened 10 days after, which is showing, I like always to look at the bigger picture. What happened 10 days after the Durban conference ended? 9/11. And I was here in Washington. I was in the White House. The plane that was crashed in Pennsylvania was supposed to be on.
What were you doing in the White House?
I came with a delegation of Knesset members.
Were you in the Knesset at the time?
I was not, but I was
advisor of some
kind. Yeah, I was a kind of, you know, they invited me as a journalist and as a lawyer and
okay.
a jurist.
And the goal of that meeting in the White House was? Do you remember?
Something about law.
Law,
no,
okay.
Nothing to do with the peace process.
Got it. Yeah. So you're in Washington on 9/11.
Yeah.
And you know that one plane was supposed to hit the White House.
Yeah.
We believe.
Yeah, but yeah. I knew it much later. I didn't know it in the
okay.
very moment.
And how does that event impact the way you feel and the way you think?
It's very interesting because to remind you what happened immediately after, there were many articles published about why do they hate us? Why do they hate us?
They being the?
The Muslims,
the Muslim
the Arabs.
World, Muslim radical world.
Why do they hate us? And I read a lot of articles of academics, Joe Esposito and Juan Cole and others. Actually, it's because we support Israel. It's very interesting because I mentioned already the president of Mesa, Juan Cole, professor. And he wrote an article claiming that, it was after 3 years. Claiming that actually the 9/11 commission wrote that what he told about them, that they conceived the terror attack because of the Jenin massacre. Now, there was not any massacre in Jenin, never happened, it was totally refuted, but where is the catch? The Jenin battle was in 2002. It was never written by the commission. But yet, he in order to connect between Israel and the terror attack of 9/11, he claimed that actually it was because of, I mean, it's first of all, it's stupid. It's stupid. I mean, how can you write something of that kind? What, Muhammad Atta and his friends, the terrorists, they were prophets, they knew what Israel is going to do in, it was so stupid. But unfortunately, that school of mind tried to connect between Israel and the terror. It's because of Israel. We hear it now. We don't have to go to 15 years before when we hear the foreign minister of Sweden, for example, saying that what happened in Paris and later on in Brussels, it's actually because they are frustrated because of the occupation. Look how they're trying to find a scapegoat. It's because of Israel. It's because of Israel. And it's a tragedy. It's a tragedy. Because you hear again and again that by academics, by politicians, by activists, that Israel is the main cause to violence in the world. Mm-hmm. I'm quoting now, mm-hmm. so many. Mm-hmm. And it reminds me the big lie of the Nazis. Jew is the greatest danger to humanity. In that time, it has been expressed by Nazis. Nowadays, it is expressed by the enlightened people. And it's a tragedy. Mm-hmm. So to deny the connection between anti-Zionism and anti-Semitism, it's a bit stupid.
There is a connection in your mind between anti-Zionism and anti-Semitism.
The very same way Jews were demonized, Israel is demonized mm-hmm. today. The very same. We are speaking about the same patterns. Demonization, delegitimization, dehumanization. The same pattern. They are lying. They are not biased. They are not only biased. Of course they are biased. But they are lying. In order to sell their goods about Israel, in order to depict Israel as a monster, they must lie. They have no other option. Because when you check the facts, well, Israel is a normal state. Israel is a normal state. We have some even hooligans, and we have some rabbis that are racist, and we have to admit it, and we have to fight against it. We have. And we have some soldiers that are not behaving according to the Geneva
conventions.
Yes, we do. Very few.
Very few.
Very few. We fight them. We fight against them. We take them to court.
They are not tolerated.
Of course they are not tolerated. But to depict Israel as a monster because of some isolated events, it's a kind of...
Okay. So, Ben-Dror, finish your personal story in this regard, in this chapter, because... Yeah. What I'm imagining, and I still imagine, that in your soul, in your heart, in your mind, you still long for peace.
As long
as you live, you will be a peace activist.
I'll tell
you. But it means something different to you today than it once did because, and now you'll tell me if I've got it right.
Yeah.
You have slammed into a certain reality where the idealism of a peace activist feels... And now we're coming back to the opening comments you heard me make in the introduction to this discussion. The real problem is, and then you tell me the extent to which I got it right, the real human tragedy is, there's nobody on the Palestinian leadership side that shares the dream that you once thought you were sharing with Yasser Arafat.
Yeah.
Am I right?
First of all, you're right. I will surprise you if I'll tell you that for some years, the good friend of mine, Marwan Barghouti, I think he shared the same kind of dream with me. I think that's what connected us.
What changed him?
It changed him because of a lot of reasons. I mean, it explained it that he thinks that Israel doesn't mean peace. He thought that the expansion of some settlements were a kind of proof that Israel does not mean peace. By the way, I didn't agree with him generally, but some criticism against Israel is legitimate. I can agree, I can disagree, but it's not demonization. The point is that all my war against the industry of lies, against those professors that lies, against those BDS campaign. It's because I'm pro-peace. I think the main obstacle to peace right now is not the settlements, which I'm not a big supporter of. It's not the biggest obstacle.
What is the biggest?
The industry of lies. Why? Because they perpetuate the problem. Why? Because they convince Palestinians to be much more against peace. Mm-hmm. Because they give them an option to destroy Israel, it will never happen. But instead of to tell them we have to find a solution, mm-hmm. we need reconciliation, we need peace.
Okay, and why are they doing this? Is it ideology? Or I'm asking you a very important question, and I haven't asked this question of others at this table. They bring a different expertise and experience. You know, very often you will hear people say, in America, there's an expression, follow the money. To what extent in the Palestinian world do you believe part of the drive to prevent a peace between Palestinians and Israel, whether it's a two-state solution or any kind of peace, is driven by economic concerns within the Palestinian leadership?
Okay. It's a very interesting and important question, because I have to admit, I don't think that there is one reason. Part of the reason is money. Follow the money. It's very interesting because Palestinians are suffering. If we take Lebanon, for example, we are talking about apartheid. They are not allowed to the labor market in many jobs, in many occupations. They are restricted in constructing. Apartheid. Apartheid. Nobody's speaking about it. Nobody's speaking about it, but about the real apartheid.
In Lebanon.
Of course, a real apartheid against Palestinians. They are not entitled to citizenship. Now, it's totally ignored. How come that it is ignored? Now, the whole story is, first of all, yes, anti-Zionism, which has historical roots. Anti-Zionism. Second is jihadism, Wahhabism, which is part of the story. I mean, it's all combined. Look what, for example, when we speak about how it is connected, what Edward Said did. Edward Said, the post-colonial school of mind. He is not alone, but he is the most prominent figure in the whole. Actually, what he did is to say that, look, the whole story is that how we are treated, we in the East, how the West is treating them. Now, he made a kind of externalization of the guilt. We Muslims, we Arabs, he's not a Muslim, but we are not responsible to anything. It's all capitalism, colonialism, imperialism, Zionism. He gave them a kind of exemption from. Now, actually what he told them, keep on complaining and complaining and complaining, that's all. Never, but never, he told them, take responsibility. If you don't have democracy, maybe it's because of you. If Israel evacuated Gaza, why don't you use the moment in order to do something for yourself, for welfare, for education, for the people? Why is the only one industry that you can develop is the industry of death? Why? I mean, we have to tell them something. We have to tell them, you have the responsibility on yourself. Now, what the BDS is doing is just the same. He is not telling people, let's do something for ourselves. He's telling them, let's hate. He's not telling them, let's make peace with the enemy. Okay, Israel is the enemy, but let's make peace with the enemy. Let's find ways to make peace. No. He is anti-Palestinian, the BDS, because he perpetuates a problem. Instead of, okay, we have to find a point that we can compromise. We have to make concessions. The other side have to make concessions. Let's strive for peace. And they are doing the opposite. Let's depict the Jews as the monster. And they do it again and again. And they do it again and again. And it's very sad because they are the enemy, the BDS and the industry of lies, they are the enemy mm-hmm. of the Arabs. They are the enemy of the Palestinians. They perpetuate the problem. Enough. Enough. I want peace. I really want peace. And what? And I'm fighting the BDS and I'm fighting the industry of lies because it is the most counterproductive for reconciliation, for peace, for human rights.
Ben-Dror, there is a distinction often made between Hamas, Fatah, and the Palestinian Authority. And there is a discussion now in America that what ISIS represents is a fundamentalist, extremist, jihadist philosophy that says any land that was once Muslim land must be Muslim land in perpetuity. We cannot permit any infidel to have sovereignty over that land. All the more so if the infidel is a Jew, but the Jew is just one example of an infidel. And that there are people in power in the Palestinian world, in the Arab world, who, for whom it would be as if you wanted them to change their soul to say to them, why don't you compromise and make peace with Israel? They would say to you, it would be like you telling me not to breathe. For me, they say, it may sound cruel. I'm just being honest from my perspective. There can't be an infidel in the Middle East. There certainly can't be an infidel in Jerusalem or in Palestine. I want to know from your perspective, to what extent is that description accurate, that there are some in the Arab world who now have power, who would say, this is all a sham, all a fake, all a lie. Because the bottom line is, never will we agree to share the land. And two-state solution is just a diplomatic expression of one simple notion. Let's share it. The Jew feels, by the way, that all of Eretz Yisrael should be ours. We feel that. We're willing to, however, make a compromise where even the first capital of our people, Hebron, ends up on their side of the two-state solution. The Jew has been willing to make that painful compromise because the Jew sees in the concept of sharing a value. And in the Palestinian world, in a piece of the Palestinian world, which is now in power,
okay,
Ben-Dror, compromise and sharing is unacceptable to who they are. To what extent do you believe that this is a problem and part of the human tragedy?
It is part of the human tragedy, no doubt about it. No doubt about it, that it is now.
Do you think, by the way, American Jews understand this?
No. No.
Does the
Many
American administration, does Washington understand this?
No. I'm afraid.
No?
No.
How can that be?
Okay. I'll tell you. Look, and that's what is making the whole story very interesting and quite sad. Why? Because Hamas and BDS, the secular wing and the religious wing, they talk in the very same language. Judith Butler and Professor Mearsheimer and Norman Finkelstein and Noam Chomsky and the Hamas speak in the same language. That's what's interesting. I mean, now, the Hamas does not really need a propaganda department. I mean, for free, he accepts it here in the United States by so many professors that actually against Israel. And by the way, Ismail Haniyeh even blessed them. Thank you for your help, you human rights activist. But, let's go back to the roots of the story. And the roots of the story, I gave a lecture in Rome immediately after Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi, the leader of ISIS, declared that he's coming to conquer Rome. And they made fun of it. Oh, we have traffic jams and he will never get to Rome. Okay, funny. But seriously, they told me, you see, there is a difference between the Hamas and ISIS. Hamas is against the Israeli occupation. We don't have any occupation, but the Hamas is against Israel, and they are against. Then I told them, look, I'm always equipped with all the materials that I need. So I immediately took out of my bag two video clips of two leaders of Hamas speaking about what? Speaking about what? Before Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi, about conquering Rome. Hamas? And they were like, what? And I told them, you don't understand the realities of this global jihad. All the organizations, all the network, from Boko Haram to Taliban to ISIS to Hamas, they all speak about Rome. Why Rome? Because Rome is the capital of Christianity. So they don't speak about Tel Aviv. I mean, you delude yourself that you think that they want the Jews. No. And then I showed them another video clip when the Hamas, the TV channel of the Hamas, out of the blue, speaking about to kill all the Christians, all the Jews, all the communists, which means liberal leftists, to the last one of them. Now, if you will ask me, don't you have moderate Muslims? Yes, we do. Don't you have people who accept the very existence of Israel as a Jewish state? Yes, we do. The BDS and the industry of lies is against them. They are promoting only the extremists, only the jihadists. They are in coalition. The Butlers and the Mearsheimers and the Finkelsteins. They are in coalition with who? With those who don't want peace, those who are against human rights, those who support the oppression of women. That's what they are doing. And this is part of the tragedy. Mm. Something terrible happened to the free thought in the American universities. Mm. Something terrible.
So my question is also, if you say to me there's an element about which you are correct, not all Muslims are extremists. There are moderate Muslims.
Yeah.
But at the moment, they're not in control. If those in control express what you just expressed, then go back to your idealism. I'm listening to you. I'm saying this is a guy who used to be Shalom Afshav, meeting with Yasser Arafat and thinking he was going to be a hero. How can there ever be peace as long as these people are in power? It has nothing to do with settlements anymore. It has something to do with boundaries, nothing to do with territories.
It's with the school of mind. It's a mindset.
Yes.
It's a mindset.
Am I right?
First of all, you are right. And let me tell you, I don't want you to be wrong about me. When I'm in Israel, I'm fighting in many aspects against my own government. I'm a peace supporter. I'm sorry that I say it, but I have to say it. I'm against the expansion of settlements. I do support the Clinton parameters.
Okay.
I do support.
But you're not against settlements because you believe
if we stop them, there would be peace.
It's a very important distinction.
Yeah. The main problem is the set of mind of Palestinians that is supported by BDS, that is supported by Hamas, that is supported by global jihad, that is supported by...
Okay, so take 1 minute. Why are you so against settlements? Because if you understand they're not the issue, and whether we build them or we don't build them, it's going to change nothing. Why are you against them?
First of all, I'm against them because I want a Jewish state, Jewish and democratic, of course. And I don't think that we need to build the one state solution. I don't want it. I don't want a binational state. I'm a Zionist. I'm a Zionist, a liberal maybe, a moderate, a peace activist, but I'm a Zionist.
Okay, but now you're only talking about how many.
You're
only about
because
there's no question, I believe,
that
you would agree that inside Israel, wherever Israel is, there should be, can be, would be a protected Arab-Israeli citizen.
Yeah.
Where, I say this all the time, most Jews don't know this, there is an Arab-Israeli on the Israeli Supreme Court.
Yeah, but the whole idea of Zionism, just like many other liberation movements, is about self-determination.
Yes.
So I'm following it. I'm an old-fashioned.
Okay, I'm just pushing you a little bit.
No.
Why do settlements get in the way of Jewish self-determination?
Because it might prevent separation to two-state.
Okay,
for
you
two
understand
peoples.
That you are so committed to an ancient vision, which your head knows is long gone and impossible. You're so committed to it emotionally in your Jewish neshama that you still find yourself making references that have nothing to do with the reality you described here for an hour.
I said it, and I have to say, this is not the obstacle right now.
Right.
This is not the obstacle, because even now, and I speak with all the highest officials in Israel, all of them.
I'm sure.
And they told me, I mean, yes, we built in the settlement, but only in the big blocks. Only in the big blocks. Which means we are not going to prevent the two-state solution when we will have a partner. That's important to say.
And when will that be?
When we will defeat the anti-Israeli campaign, when we will defeat the industry of lies, when we will defeat the BDS.
Okay, I say this with all respect, because I've become a huge fan of yours in this hour. I say this in all respect. It's the first time you've said something that does not fit all of your analysis. It has nothing to do with what we defeat. It has to do with a change of mindset and soul. It's not even mindset. Ben-Dror, it will take a change of soul in the Palestinian leadership for you to have peace.
You know what? I'll tell you something. Look, speaking about global jihad, which is a big obstacle now to any kind of peace, which is terrorizing not Israel, but Europe, Brussels, Paris. And you know who are the main victims of global jihad? We know about Brussels and Paris, but who are the main victims? The main victims of global jihad, and I'm following all the sources of information. Muslims are the victims. 99% of the victims of the global jihad are not Israelis and not Zionists and not Americans and not Europeans. We are speaking about Muslims. Nobody cares about them. Because, I mean, when they are killed in Nigeria or in Chad or in Cameroon, most time we don't even hear about it. But Boko Haram is killing them. Taliban is killing them. Al-Qaeda is killing them. Killing Muslims.
Okay, what's the therefore?
Now, I have this kind of dream, which is now I'm connecting to you, getting back to reality. And I have a dream. I really have a dream that Muslims will stand up against the global jihad, Muslims. For the first time after many years, I read a new poll that was published just yesterday, saying that the support in the global jihad among youngsters is getting down. Now, is it a turning point? I have no idea. But in many ways, I'm not only realistic, I'm also a dreamer, I have to admit it.
I'm glad you're a dreamer. I love the dreams.
So I'm a dreamer, and I'm always looking for human beings who are considered to be enemies. And that's why I became a close friend of Marwan Barghouti, for example. I want this kind of dream, a common dream. And when I want a Jewish state, it's not because I'm a nationalist that is against Palestinians. No, I respect their right because I do believe in self-determination for the Armenians, for the Croatians, that's the main idea that is preventing conflicts, not the opposite. Yes, I do want a Jewish majority and full rights for the Muslim Arab minority in Israel. I do want. That's my vision. Now, I know that there are difficulties. I know that there is, and you were completely right about this mindset that is against any peace. I know it. It's not that I cannot ignore it. I'm speaking about it. But I do know that what I'm right now fighting against, the BDS and the anti-Israeli campaign, they perpetuate the suffering of the Palestinians. Israel is prospering. I mean, even with, I mean, I don't like them. But Israel is doing well. Palestinians are suffering. I don't want anybody to suffer. Mm-hmm. I don't want anybody to suffer because as long as they suffer, I might suffer too, because they will keep on waging wars against me. But who is convincing them to wage a war against me? It's those people, Judith Butler and Omar Barghouti and Ali Abu Nima and all the enemies of peace, the enemies of reconciliation. They are a huge problem. And that's why I write against them. That's why I'm publishing a book against the industry of lies. That's why I'm proving, only by facts, not by my political views, that they are lying, manipulating, and they are perpetuating the suffering. That's why I'm waging this kind of war against them. It has nothing to do, I mean, about political views. Maybe we disagree. It's fair enough.
Ben-Dror Yemini, you are out of this world. We have only scratched the surface. You know the English phrase. We have only scratched. There is so much I want to talk to you about. You must promise.
I'll come again.
I'll promise again when
my book will be published.
I will love to promote it. And if I'm ever in Israel, I'm going to look you up and we'll see you there too.
It's a pleasure.
But you must promise to come back.
Yeah.
Kol tuv v'hatzlacha in all you do.
Thank you so much.
Toda rabba.
Thank you.
Fabulous, fabulous, my friend.
Thank you.
Fabulous. Whoa. The thoughts of Ben-Dror Yemini. Again, he's senior journalist with Yediot Ahranot and the author of The Industry of Lies, Myths and Facts Regarding the Middle East Conflict. My thanks also to Shachar Azani, and stand with us for helping to arrange our meeting with Ben-Dror Yemini. As always, I invite you to be in touch with me with any thoughts or comments you may have to any of the ideas expressed on this edition of L'Chaim. Please email me, write me, post it on our Facebook wall, or tweet me. I look forward to hearing from you. Until the next time, I'm Mark Golub. L'chaim, my friends, to life.
Jewish Education in Media.
We would be pleased to send a complimentary DVD of this program to anyone who wishes to support JBS, the Jewish Broadcasting Service, with a tax-deductible gift of $36, double chai, or more, to the nonprofit organization Jewish Education in Media. Simply visit the JBS homepage and click on the Donate button to make a donation by PayPal or your credit card. And please indicate the program for which you would like a DVD. Or you can send your tax-deductible check made out to GEM, Post Office Box 180, Riverdale Station, Bronx, New York, 10471. And again, please remember to indicate which program you would like to receive with our compliments. And we thank you for your kind support.